Hello everyone. Welcome for this module where we will explain deep learning on graphs. So we'll have three different lessons, and this is the first one dealing with node embedding. And it will be an opportunity to learn about language model in the setting of graphs. So here we will study a particular setting where you have your task will be to consider a large graph, only one such a fixed graph, and there is no signal on the graph, meaning that there is no meta data or any variable sitting on edges or nodes. The only thing you have is access to this large graph, and your task will be to try to do node embedding. So to construct a mapping from the nodes to a vector space in order to do a subsequent task like classification, clustering, or anything. So the typical example of such a task is what is called community detection, where you have, let's say, a social graph where nodes represent persons, and you want to cluster this graph in a sub-community or groups where people interact more within the group than with outside of the group. So in this lesson, we will mainly see two algorithms, which are DeepWalk and Node2Vec. They rely both on a language model which was first developed in natural language processing adapted to graphs. But DeepWalk will be an opportunity for us to study hierarchical softmax and Node2Vec to study negative sampling. So let's start with a small recap about what a language model is. So we don't need to know a lot of NLP in order to study this. The goal here will be given a corpus, so let's say of text for now. We try to estimate the likelihood of a specific sequence of words. So the language model, the most naive approach would be to try to predict the next word in a sentence given the very few first words of the sentence. So this is not a task that is stationary in a sense. At the beginning of the sentence, you have no information, whereas at the end of the sentence, you have a lot of information, so the task is much easier. So in order to stationarize a little bit the learning process, people had the idea to take a window and to try to predict the central word based on the context word. So the central word in the window, here denoted by the all, the W, as a function of the context word C1, C2, C3, and C4. So here we'll study yet another model, which is called the skipgram model, where instead of predicting the central word from the context word, we'll do basically the opposite. From the central word, you'd like to predict what is the probability of seeing this context word. And as I said, you will use a window here, a window of size 5, and then you will slide the window by 1 unit to the right each time. So the first thing you can do in such a setting is based on your corpus, you can construct a so-called multiset big D, which consists of all pairs of central word W and context word C. So in this case, in the red window, I have the central word, which is all. You see that I'm repeating it here. And all the context word multiset of word and are here. And so I get with a window of size 5, the central word is all and 4 different pairs of word and context. When I'm sliding the window by 1, the central word now will be word, which was a context in my previous window, and so on. So this is the way I'm constructing D. And now I need to have a probabilistic model in order to make an estimation of the likelihood of any context word given the W central word. So this is what is written formally here, where theta is taking into account all the parameters of my model. W is the central word, and C is the context word. So P of C, knowing W and given all the parameters theta, is basically the likelihood of seeing the context word C when I have a central word W in all my corpus, which is now only this big multiset. So you see that here I'm not taking into account the order of the words in the window. I cannot distinguish multiset of all word or of multiset all word and so on. But so this is a quite naive model of a language model, but you will see that you are able to learn meaningful embedding for the world in a semantic way. So the theta here are the parameters of my model, and what are the parameters here? They are only the vectors that I am constructing for each word or each context word. So given this vector, which are denoted by U here, I need to compute a probability. So the simplest thing you can think of is taking the scalar product of the embedding. So the reason we will take the scalar product is we want to put words with the same kind of semantic close together in the embedding space. So you want to have a large scalar product if the two words are similar. So, but this scalar product is something, is a real that might be negative. So in order to transform this scalar product into a probability, you pass it through a softmax. So meaning that you are taking the exponent of all the possible scalar product, and you are normalizing where this sum here, W is fixed, is the same as here and here, but the sum here is on all possible context words in my dataset, in my corpus. So theta is a shortcut for denoting all the embedding for central word and context word. So these vectors. So here you see that computing this softmax will not be tractable in any practical scenario, because you are summing over a huge sum over there. The size of the sum here is of the order of the number of words in your corpus, so the different words in your corpus, so the size of the vocabulary. So this is where people came out with different strategies. The first one I want to describe is so-called hierarchical softmax. So you will modify slightly the skipgram model in order to avoid this huge computation. And the way you are modifying the computation is through this very simple new parametrization. So you put all the context word into the leaves of a binary tree, like represented here. And now, for any given central word W, instead of computing the scalar product of the embedding of W with the embedding of C, you will follow this path in order to compute the probability of seeing the context word C given W. So you have some hidden state sitting on the binary tree, and each hidden state here will correspond to a vector. So this is not anymore a word, but you associate to this hidden state a vector. And when you are following this path here, which is denoted pi of c, you will take the scalar product of the hidden vector with the central word vector UW. So this scalar product is not a probability, and you want a probability at the end. So in order to get a probability from just a real number, you pass it through a sigmoid function, which is denoted here if you do not recall. So you see that here you are still computing the probability of seeing the context word C given central word W, but in a much simpler way, because you get rid of the huge sum that appeared in the skip graph model. And here, the number of multiplication you need to do is much lower than previously, because the number of leaves here is of the order of the size of the vocabulary, so C. But the depth of the tree, of course, is of order only log n. So you are reducing the complexity from linear to log in the size of the vocabulary. So in the DeepWalk model, they apply exactly this hierarchical soft max strategy. So, but you have to define what is a corpus when you are dealing with a graph. So the corpus here is just the sequences visited by a random walk on your graph. So what you will do is you take your, again, you have one big fixed graph. You will start a lot of different random walks from different vertices of these graphs. You will interpret each of these random walks as a new sentence in your corpus, and then you can apply exactly the language model that we described. If you want to be efficient in the hierarchical softmax, you can also use a trick in the building of your binary tree here. You want to have short paths for the most common of them, so you can use Huffman coding in order to get a shorter path for frequent context word. So this is actually taken from the paper, so the description, the pseudocode for the algorithm. So the main algorithm is here. This is the DeepWalk. The parameter given by the vectors you are computing for each vertex is this big matrix. V is the number of vertices, and D is the dimension of the vectors. There are hyperparameters like the window size in the skip graph model, the embedding size D. Gamma is the number of random walks you will run in your graph, and T is the length of the random walk. Now you see that there is a loop here, for loop here. So this is just I is a counter for the number of random walk. You shuffle all the vertices, you do one random walk, and on this random walk, you apply what they call the skip graph model. And the skip graph model is given here. So this is a very short description of what I just presented. You are just trying to maximize the probability. So here it's a loss, okay? So you have a minus log of the probability, and this probability is given by this expression. Okay, depending on the parameter big phi, and of course you are doing a standard SGD gradient descent in order to optimize the parameter phi. So that's it for DeepWalk. Now I will discuss another way of dealing with the problem of computation in the skip graph model, which is known as negative sampling. So the way you build your corpus is exactly the same as before. You have a sliding window here of size 5, central word, context word, and so on. You construct the pairs. But now you will modify slightly the skip graph model in a different way. What you want to do is to predict a binary random variable. So this B is for binary because it's 0, 1. And it's 1 only is a couple WC belongs to your corpus. So W is a central word and C is a context word. So what you, instead of predicting C knowing W, here you are observing W and C and you try to predict whether this particular pair is in your corpus or not. So this is what is written in formally here. And again, the same trick as before, you want to build embeddings for W and C, and you want this embedding to be closed when the two words are basically the same meaning. So you are starting from the scalar product of this embedding. If they appear frequently together, this will be you hope that this will be high. And since this is a real number, you pass it through a sigmoid in order to get a probability. Now, instead of maximizing this, what we did before for the Skibra model or the hierarchical softmax, we want to maximize the probability of B being 1 given a certain pair, W and C. So it turns out that this is a very simple task because you only have positive examples. So if you want to maximize this big product, what you do is very simple. You basically align all the vectors here. So you will get all this scalar product will be big, and you let the norm of this vector go to infinity, and you see that all this probability will go to 1, so the product will go to 1. Okay, so this is a trivial solution to our problem where because you are only learning on positive example, what the algorithm would do is just maximize the similarity of all the words, and that's not at all what we want to do. So in order to deal with this issue, you need to introduce what are called negative examples. So examples that are not present in your data set. So you need to have to give your algorithm some example where B is equal to 0. So this is what we call negative examples. So this corresponds to this D prime corresponding to negative example. And here you have a lot of way to generate negative examples. So if you look at the original paper, Wertoweck, where they introduce this negative sampling technique in an NLP setting, the way they generate this set D prime of negative examples was for each a pair WC in the positive example, you will generate k different samples, k negative samples. WC1, WCK, where W is a central word. And now in order to, so W is the same as here. Now in order to pick the C1, C2, and CK, you can have a lot of freedom though. And what they suggest is actually to take this C1, CK randomly in your corpus according to distribution. Which is not exactly the empirical distribution of the context word, but it's an empirical distribution raised to a power which is actually less than 1. So this is basically one of the contribution of Nodetoveck, mainly to modify the parametrization of the Skipgram model, and instead of using hierarchical softmax, to use negative sampling. The other contribution of Nodetoveck is in the way the author generates the random walk. So it's not anymore unbiased random walk. Actually, it's a random walk with a memory. So here, this is a picture from the original paper. So let's say that You just move from vertex T to vertex V. So now you are sitting here and you need to decide what is your next move. In order to make this decision, you will choose one of your neighbor at random, but not with the same probability if it's T, so where you are coming from. If it's a neighbor of both you and T, where you are coming from, so if it's a neighbor of U but not a neighbor of T. So you see that alpha, actually, this parameter here, is a new parameter, and you will pick one of this edge according to a probability which is proportional to alpha. So you will come back to your origin with probability 1 over p. You will go to a sibling if you want, x1, which is a neighbor of v and t with probability proportional to 1, and you will go to further away from t to a neighbor of v with a probability which is proportional to 1 over q. Of course, you are renormalizing everything in order to make this a probability. So what you see here is that basically the parameter p, by playing with it, you can ask the random walls to come back to its origin or to try to explore a bit more the network. So when p is small, you tend to be close to your origin, and when p is large, and you have a tendency to explore the rest of the network. The parameter q is here in order to try also to escape from T. Note that x1 is also a neighbor of T. So again, if Q is bigger than 1, so it's large, then you have a tendency to explore first a neighbor of T. So it's a bit like a breadth first search. But when Q is small, smaller than 1, then you have a tendency to go further away from your origin T. So here is one example, again taken from the Node2Vec paper, where they run their algorithm on a data set from Les Misérables. So this is a relatively small network with 77 nodes on a bit more than 250 edges, where each node corresponds to a character. And you have an edge if they appear in the same chapter of the book. So they have some kind of interaction in Les Misérables. So on the top figure here, the only thing that is different between the two figures is the parameter P and Q as just described for generating the corpus, the random walk. Then the Node2Vec algorithm is computing an embedding for each node, and the color is obtained by doing a clustering on this node embedding. So nodes with similar color will be close together in the embedding space. So you see here that the parameter Q actually is relatively small. So here, when Q is small, you have a tendency to be further away from the network. And P is equal to 1. So what you observe is that you put together nodes which form a kind of community. So they have a lot of interaction with each other. To the contrary, here, you see that you have red vertices which have no connection at all, but the colors, the corresponding to similar embedding again, correspond to function or structural equivalence of the nodes. So, for example, you see that the blue vertices correspond actually to bridges between two different communities. Okay, they connect different communities. Yellow people are correspond to mainly leaves actually. So people who do not have a lot of interaction with others. So here one last result taken from one of the papers. So guess from which paper these results are taken from. So here the task is a multi-level classification where you have big graphs. And now it's a little bit different from what I presented at the beginning because now you have label on nodes, but only a fraction of this label is revealed. And you need to guess the remaining one, the one which are hidden to you. And then you can compute a F1 score on this prediction. And the higher the better here. And here you see a few numbers corresponding to different data sets where not correspond to different entities depending on the data set. So that's it for this first part where we looked at a language model on one fixed graph where there is no signal and the basic example being committee detection. Thank you.